As a rule, the larger the sediment size, the higher the velocity of waves is required to transport them. What I'm about to do is an experiment to show the impact that swash has on sediment. I've arranged four different objects from left to right according to their weight. Now shortly I'm going to place them in the water next to a stake and we're going to see what happens. As you've just seen, when the waves come in, the heavier objects closer to the stick have stayed where they are, but the lighter objects have been either washed up on the beach or even dragged backwards. There is a maximum depth to which waves will cause any significant water movement. We call this depth the wave base. Thus, below the wave base, waves have no impact on the sediments below. However, when waves enter shallow water, the usual orbital motion of water becomes elliptical. The waves slow down and become steeper and higher. This is called shoaling. When the waves become too high relative to the water's depth, the waves break. Since the water is shallow, the breaking waves are able to push the sediment up towards the beach. This flow of water moving up a beach is called swash. The returning flow of water down a beach is called backwash, and also drags sediment back with it. Diffraction occurs when waves bend around a barrier, such as an offshore island like Owaya Island off the coast of Mirowai. Once waves pass the barrier, they spread out in all directions rather than carrying on straight. Refraction occurs in shallow water, when approaching ocean waves swing around headlands because the waves slow down in the shallow water. As a result, the refracting part of the wave may be forced to break with the other part of the wave that's still travelling in the deeper water towards the beach. Refraction increases erosion at headlands, and deposition tends to take place in the lower energy bays and beaches. For instance, on a small scale, examine the waves approaching this rock at Mirowai Bay. The waves pass the rock and curve around the rock and deposit a small ridge of sand here, a bit like a miniature spit. On a bigger scale, waves bend around islands, taking sediment with them. In some instances, you can walk to the island at low tide, like this one, Motocr Island, here in Beachlands. Eventually, when enough sediment is built up, the spit will fully connect with an island and form a tombolo, such as this one here at Cape Maria van Diemen in the far north of New Zealand. The prevailing wind direction will cause the waves to approach the beach at an angle. As a result, the sediment that moves up the beach with swash will also be moved at an angle. Likewise, the backwash will move the sediment back down the beach at an angle. Thus, sediment will travel back and forth along the beach in a zigzag-like motion. We call this process longshore drift. In the case of Mirowai, the prevailing wind direction is southwesterly. Therefore, longshore drift will zigzag northwards. When longshore drift encounters a river mouth or a change in direction of the coastline, sediment can be deposited, forming a spit. For example, this spit at Rarawa Beach in Northland has formed in a southerly direction, indicating that the dominant longshore drift here is also southerly. Sometimes, longshore drift will cause the sand to deposit right across the river mouth, forming a bar. As a consequence, many bars have lagoons and wetlands behind them. Because of longshore drift, one beach's loss is another beach's gain. However, when humans interfere with the natural processes by removing sediment through either dredging sand for canal developments, marinas, or sand mining, it can deprive another beach of its naturally replenishing sand. To mitigate this, people have built groynes to catch the drifting sand. The sand piling up behind this groyne at Mission Bay in Auckland gives some idea of how much sand may be carried away by the prevailing longshore drift. Waves can either build beaches up or erode them. It is normal for beaches to have a summer and a winter profile. Smaller waves have a stronger swash than backwash and build beaches up in the summer. They are called constructive waves. During winter, there are frequent storms. Waves are higher and more frequent. These waves have a stronger backwash than swash and erode the beach. Anything built on or near the beach is at risk of being undermined and carried away by the waves. For example, Mirowai's life-saving tower had to be moved by a crane 100 meters back from where it used to stand after waves scoured the dunes in 2008. Many beaches have a berm, which marks the edge of the swash zone, such as this one at Little Buckland's Beach. However, Mirowai lacks this feature due to the dominance of large waves washing such features away. Sometimes, either erosion or deposition of a beach can become a dominant trend over a long period of time. At Mirowai, some parts of the beach have plenty of sand. For example, at the river mouth of the Akuritoto stream, there is a long stretch of beach due to the continual replenishing of sediment from the stream. However, at the southern end of Mirowai, closest to the headland, erosion has been threatening human development. I'm standing here at the southern end of Mirowai Beach. The first time I came here was actually in the early 1990s when the frontal dunes were not far from where I'm standing now. But in the time since then, erosion has been so severe that it's been threatening the car park and the council had to decide to do something about it. Previous local councils put rocks and gabion baskets onto the beach to try and protect it. Over the years, the local authorities have spent millions of dollars fighting a losing battle against the erosion of the dunes. Consequently, the former Auckland Regional Council decided to relocate this car park further back from the beach. Often, human attempts to prevent erosion have ended up creating more erosion. For instance, the building of a seawall, such as this one here at Little Buckland's Beach. When the waves hit the wall, it is reflected. The backwash reflected from the wall drags away sand from the beach. Notice how along the same stretch of sea wall at low tide, the beach has been stripped off its sand. At many Auckland beaches, such as Mission Bay, the council has had to truck in sand from elsewhere to replace the lost sand. This sea wall protecting the cliff between Mellons Bay and Howick Beach has itself become the victim to the forces of waves. Given the failure of seawalls and other hard structures, new approaches are being taken to coastal management. Some people are advocating new approaches to coastal management. For example, the creation of an artificial sand dune, such as this one here at Mirowai Beach.